Well, it's always the case, I suppose, when you're talking to somebody with a big story to tell and they've got so many interesting events to share with us. But it is those types of events that shape who we finally become. As Mr. Ronnie Castles has just told me about the incident that he witnessed in his earlier years as about age, what, seven or
Seven
eight or
going eight,
thereabouts,
yeah.
right? How does this influence you at school when you're with your friends now attending school, this memory of the event?
Well, that was a big dramatic event, but they were everyday events. And I would argue with my friends, don't call black people those names. So at times I would be a bit isolated. I didn't care. But I stood up against bullying of all kinds. And I link that to the empathy that my mother and father gave me for all human beings. I also abhor the authoritarianism of South African schools and education, which even English-speaking white school kids had, corporal punishment, the prefect system, and you get severely punished. And that brought out something of the rebel within me. It develops out of primary school, which is Yeovil, into high school, which is King Edwards. And in the process, I also fall prey to another South African drug, and that's sport. And we have the privileges. So it's athletics and swimming and cricket and rugby, football and so on. And I became besotted and I neglected studies. But the second big change comes about in my matric years. These are 2 years then, age 16, 17. And our history teacher said that King Edwards in Houghton says to us, this term we're going to study the French Revolution. And I hear the word revolution, and without realizing it, for the first time, I'm now
Now you paid
listening,
attention,
all ears.
Yes.
And he says there's this great slogan, liberty, equality, fraternity, which arises out of that revolution, 1789, and this has impelled world forces and history of the haves and the have-nots ever since. We discuss what they mean, and then he says, okay, boys, here we are in Houghton, very beautiful, leafy suburb. He says, if you go out on the street corner and you preach liberty, equality, fraternity, what do you think the good residents are going to make of what you're saying? And then we have a big debate, and he says, okay, now you go down Louis Botha Avenue for 15 kilometers, and we're at Alexander Township. And there you go, and you stand on a soapbox and you preach liberty, equality, fraternity. What are the good people there? What's their reaction? Now, he gave us the lessons of the French nobility and the absolute monarchs of Europe, waxing in luxury over the downtrodden masses. And he has to be careful. This is a police state. But because my mind was opened by my mother and father, I could see the imagery of African and white society. And I drank that in, and my mark soared. I began to do so well at school. I began to read like crazy, and I became very interested in writing and poetry. Leaving school, I stopped crossing the color line and getting involved with the Nat Nakazes, the Lewis and Causeys, Chris McGregors, the jazz people of the day as well, King Kong and the Divas and these parties. And it totally changes my life. I'm working for a film studio and I now feel that, Ronnie, you freed yourself. You're no longer part of white society. You don't even obey the rules. Just drinking with my black brothers and sisters.
And you're embraced by them. There were no problems for you.
Absolutely. No, no. I mean, one was so accepted. Yes. Because if you cross the colour lines in that kind of period, people realised this is a brother under the skin. Mm. It was a fantastic thing.
But I mean, for you, you were quite comfortable with that. You know,
I was made to feel so comfortable, more comfortable than in white society, because in my white community, be it the Jewish community, be it school chums and those post-school, if you talked in an open way, you got into problems, even with close friends.
Yes.
They started shunning me. You know, Ronnie, trouble with you is you're something of a communist.
Mm.
And I would say to them, a communist? I don't even know what that means. Do you mean because I'm saying that I'm prepared to have black friends that I'm a communist? If that's communism, you know,
and
roll
you embrace
it on.
It. Yeah.
And you know, in a sense, I put it simply, but when you look at the lives of the Bram Fishers, the Slovos, Ruth and Joe and the others, the Ben Turok you talked about, the initial thing from this minority of whites was that the first thing they abhorred was the racism. And then as they examined what creates the racism, they then came to understand class, society, privilege, read Marxism. And that's what drew me as well more into the struggle. You know, there's...
But you know what I want you to do for me now is, I mean, you go and work for Liver Brothers at one point in Durban.
Yes.
You also lived in Cape Town. It's just to paint a picture for me of the experiences in Joburg, in Durban, and Cape Town, because these still are the three major metros in our country.
Sure.
And for purposes of, you know, today, I'm trying to imagine how they were like, how different they were from each other, at least from your point of view.
Oh, absolutely. So it's South Africa of the late 50s. Now, I leave school in 57.
Yeah.
And I'm initially working in Joburg, giving you an idea of the interaction, and especially in Hillbrow, which although it's a white suburb, it's bohemian. There are intellectuals there, people doing the writing and the poetry and so on.
Well, you probably set the stage for some of us, because when we came in the 80s, right into Hillbrow, the same thing continued at that time.
You found this, but there would have been more black people at that stage.
Absolutely.
Obviously, they're the people working as waiters and so on in the cafes. But the guys like you would kind of sneak in, not supposed to be there at night, but you'd have friends like me. I'd put you up. We'd have some what we called multiracial or non-racial parties, very mixed, but we'd have to keep it a bit quiet. People would be watching out in case of police raid, etc. It was uproarious stuff. It was breaking the law. It was living on the edge. It was highly exciting. There were a few political people around. So Robert Kirscher and Duma Nokwe came to some of these parties, and they found in me a young white who wasn't just there for the music and the poetry or the writing. And they started talking to me about ANC and saying I should come and give a little bit of time to them in their office downtown. Mm. This was just before the ANC is banned. Mm. So Joburg's got something of this nature in the central town area as well. There are communists like Slovo and Harold Walpi, etc., who'd been living in Yeovil as well. Mm. There were slogans on walls, an attack on communism is an attack on you, which affected me. Most whites didn't see this happening and just would only know about black society through what they read in the newspaper, the Star,
Grand
Daily Mail. Yeah. But, you know, it was white man's talk and white man's views. People were highly intimidated, the whites, by apartheid, didn't dare speak out. And as for the African people, organized through ANC and later when it broke away, the PAC, there were always the rumblings of discontent. Mm. But the lid was sealed very heavily until Sharpeville broke out. At that time, I transfer from a film company here to work for Lever Brothers Film Department in Durban. The interesting thing about Durban is because it's not such a huge mega city as Joburg, you came into greater contact through the Indian community, which was still ensconced in part of the central part of Durban. Mm. I started making friends there. I've got my connections with the ANC, and it was mainly a number of young Indian comrades, Ibrahim, Sunny Singh, people like that, Billy Nair, who's in the trade union leader at that time. So they within a few blocks of where I was working at Lever Brothers. I'd go and spend lunchtime in the Indian part of town talking with these guys. And then after work, I would meet up with them. At that point, young Africans and older would come into the Indian part of the town where the former ANC, now banned, but the Indian Congress and New Age, the paper, had their offices. So I was now meeting a lot of young African ANC activists, and we had our party. Cape Town, given the District 6 situation, was also mirrored that, because District 6 was almost cheek by jowl with the centre of Cape Town. Mm. So I constantly went into District 6 and had friends in District 6. And we would have wonderful parties at remote parts of the Cape Peninsula, camping for the whole weekend. It gave one a feeling of what South Africa could be like without apartheid.
Sure. I mean, this is a rich texture, cosmopolitan life that you live. I mean, for your years at the time in the South Africa of the time when the apartheid was now being entrenched full time.
Absolutely.
And here you are being exposed to all the communities of South Africa. Ronnie Castles has just published a book. It's called Catching Tadpoles, The Shaping of a Young Rebel. And of course, urban cosmopolitan, as you can hear. Joburg raised, lived in Durban, spent time in Cape Town as well. But all of those experiences shape the Ronnie Castles that we came to know. We'll be picking up the conversation in a moment.